Welcome to St. Paul Central High School as TSB Television proudly presents our first game of high school girls basketball. Our first regular season game, that is. We have a early season matchup proven to be a very exciting contest. We've got the St. Paul Central Minutemen going up against the Chanhassen Storm. St. Paul Central coming in at 4-0, Chanhassen at 2-1. Hello everyone, I'm Mike Peden. Thank you for joining us. St. Paul Central, with one of their best teams since their state tournament years from 2007 and 2008. First 4-0 start since the 2006-07 season when they won the Class 4A state championship with an undefeated record. Early season rankings have them at number 5 in Class 4A, and a lot of it has to do with a fairly cohesive group, even if they're an underrated one. You've got Sade, Chatman inside. Rayna, Sherow also does a lot of dirty work on the boards, cleaning up on offense and defense, and a solid point guard in Betsy McDonald, who understands her IQ. Head coach Willie Taylor says this team will be tested throughout the year and may have the best chance to reach a state tournament for the first time since 2008. Chanhassen at 2-1. They suffered their first loss of the season to defending 2A champion Providence Academy at the Breakdown Sports USA Tip-Off Classic. But don't pass over this group. They were number 7 in the preseason rankings in Class 4A. They don't have a lot of size, but they have a lot of quick guards, very fast. They're going to push the tempo frequently. And this team knows what it takes to play together. They won the Minnesota Conference last year with their best record in school history, and had they not been upset in double overtime by Prior Lake in the first round of the section tournament, who knows what might have happened, but a lot of bookies have them picked to be one of the sleepers in Class 4A. Let's take a look at the keys to the game quickly. For Chanhassen, they'll want to be under control at all times, especially with St. Paul Central's full court pressure defense. Decision making will be key as a result. And finally, they need to get through some adversity. They lost their inside post player, Tori Shear, to an ACL tear. They have a few other players ill, unable to play tonight. So Chanhassen will be getting a considerable test. St. Paul Central, they cannot get tired. They have to be patient because Chanhassen will be quick. They want to make sure they score inside. They have two great players to do that in Sade Chatman and Rayna Sherow, although Chatman not as aggressive on the offensive side. And they're going to need to stop transition baskets in order to contain Chanhassen's tempo. Tip-off is coming up in a few minutes. You're watching High School Girls Basketball. Welcome back to St. Paul Central High School. Let's take a look at the starting lineups. We'll start with Chanhassen. Number 3, Olivia Wilder. She's a 5'10 guard. Number 4, Daniel Gitson, a 5'10 guard. Number 10, Becca Smith, a 5'5 guard. Number 30, Anna Lecce, a 5'7 guard. And number 50, Tia Wright, 5'8 forward. Lauren Shifflett, a little under the weather, will not start tonight. St. Paul Central will start Lyric Williams, number 3. She's a 5'5 guard. Number 5, Betsy McDonald. She's a 5'7 guard. Number 11, Sade Chatman, 6'3 center. Number 14, Jada Haynes, 5'7 guard. And number 15, Rayna Sherow, 6'2 center. And here we go, Chanhassen wearing the white jersey, St. Paul Central wearing the black. That's Jada Haynes handing it over to Betsy McDonald. McDonald, described by Willie Taylor, as one of his favorite players he has ever coached. Of course, he's coached since 99. He has a long list of players, and that's just as a head coach. Remember, Willie Taylor served as an assistant under Tom Gunderson at schools like Moundsview and Harding. Here's McDonald weaving through, can't get the layup. Rebound, and the kiss off the glass for Sade Chatman. Willie Taylor wants to see more of that out of Sade Chatman. She's going to UAB. And here's Chanhassen's first possession. Again, there's Tia Wright starting in place of Giflett, or Shifflett. Becca Smith launches a 3, in and out. Rebound. And the putback for Chanhassen. And we've got a stoppage in play. The basket was from Lecce. And we have a stoppage in play because of some moisture or debris on the court. In any case, has to be cleared up. The basket is good. Lecce did score. And we resume action. Lyric Williams in there, losing the ball to Becca Smith. Lyric Williams starting in the place of Jada Jones, who is coming off a hamstring injury. Chanhassen almost loses the ball, and they do call a backcourt violation. Central did not get a deflection. Haynes to inbound. Here's Sherow over to Haynes. Chatman at the top of the key goes to McDonald. McDonald out to Williams. Chanhassen running a matchup, or I should say man-to-man defense. Rayna Sherow on the block, no good. Rebound, Olivia Wilder. Chanhassen on the run, they have numbers. Wilder coast to coast, can't finish. Becca Smith with the offensive rebound. Tries to get to Lecce, and Lecce can't save it in time. The pass was a little low. Williams in trouble, losing the ball to Lecce. Becca Smith is open this time, and a nice shovel pass over to Olivia Wilder, who gets her first field goal. Saw Williams coming and dumped the ball off as a nice fake on offense. But they leave Rayna Sherow open on the other end, and she gets a transition bucket. Smith going through traffic and scores. Smith is on the board. McDonald tried to bounce it, and a kickball is ruled as Annalecci made the contact. And here's our first appearance of Lauren Shifflett, number 32. She is Chanhassen's top scorer. Chelsea Kircher then the game for Central, and her three-pointer's a little too strong, but it was ruled off of Chanhassen, so Central will maintain possession. Still early in the first half. And Chanhassen makes a quick substitution. Number 20, Jill Wilder. Kizer deflected and picked up by Becca Smith, who records a steal. But she loses the ball right back to Chatman. Sherow doesn't quite have breakaway speed, so she'll dump out to the option. Missing the three-pointer was number 12 for Central, Jada Jones, who is back. Sade Chatman can't get the rebound or the putback. But she'll get another try thanks to Sherow, who set her up. And Chanhassen will take a timeout. We are tied up at 6 with 14:28 remaining in the first half. Well, nice to see Jada Jones back. Not starting yet, but it might be because of Lyric Williams, number 3. I talked with Willie Taylor beforehand. He said she came in expecting to compete for a starting spot. Whether or not she hangs on to it, hard to say. But she said the ball handling, Taylor said her ball handling was better. She has some quickness. Played for the Minnesota Stars AAU over the summer, so a talented group over there, as always. And Central learning a lot about themselves. Again, they haven't had a roster this strong in some time. There was some hope when Genvante Hill enrolled at Central, but the Spiders' skills didn't quite pan out the way they hoped. Had some trouble with free throw shooting, but Willie Taylor, never one to bow under pressure. He is the winningest coach in St. Paul City Conference history. Becca Smith thought about a three, but instead has a hole inside, but she can't finish, and the rebound, Chelsea Kizer, contact, no foul called. Smith picks it up. Smith open in the corner. Bullseye. McDonald to Jones. Sade Chatman, or that was Sherow. Now Sade Chatman with the pull-up, too strong. Sherow inside, and one. Foul on Shifflett. It's our first foul of the game. And Sherow going to the line, not the most accurate of free throw shooters, but has shown some improvement. Central's first game of the year, a victory over New Prague. They shot 4 of 20 from the line. Sherow cannot complete the three-point play. Fortune's a little better after that. But the Twin Towers from Central doing all the scoring thus far. Chatman to Jada Jones. Jones, underhand layup no good. May have hit air a little too early. Here's Wright for two, no good. Sherow with the board as it went off the heel. Very fast pace thus far. Sherow off the mark, and it's off of Chanhassen, so it will, no, it's off of Central, so we're, it is off of Chanhassen. Sometimes the direction can confuse me a little bit. Chelsea Kizer will inbound. Willie mentioned that Kizer might get reduced playing time when Jada Jones can return in full strength, but she does bring some quickness. Passes off target, and now we're going to Chanhassen's direction. One player you will not see for Chanhassen is Abby Rolfe, number 12. She's battling an illness. At least we won't expect to see much of her. There's Shiplett. Losing the ball to a quick Jada Jones. And here comes Jones. She can't finish. Fight for the ball, and it's picked up by Litchie. Shiplett can't get around Sherow. And she was pushed out of bounds, so good break for Chanhassen. Litchie will inbound. Becca Smith wants that three. It's a common move you'll see in high school basketball. You see LaShondra Curtis in the game now for St. Paul Central. And now Chanhassen fires a three, but Olivia Wilder's off target. Lyric Williams gets the rebound and gets the deflection off of Chanhassen. She had three players converge on her position. McDonald almost lost the handle. There is a 10-second half-court rule, of course, even though there's no shot clock, and she does lose it thanks to the poke from behind. Central can't save it. That's one thing in basketball some players sometimes forget, in other sports too. When you get past somebody, they are definitely behind you, and so that's how you can sneak up and get pokes like you see frequently in the sport of basketball. Yeah.
Rainbow jumper is good from Tia Wright.
And good anticipation, right with the steal. And Chanhassen gets the roll. That's Danielle Gitson who gets on the board. And Chanhassen takes her largest lead of the game, but there's still a long time to go. Chanhassen showing a little full court pressure of their own. Smith almost got the steal off the inbound play. Chatman, no. Jump ball. And the possession arrow favors Chanhassen. Shifflett going back in. Whistle. Chanhassen stepped on the line, so they turn it over. But Central having some trouble getting through Chanhassen's press. There's another example. New player in for Chanhassen, that's Maggie Udston. And getting the bucket, Danielle Gitson again on the fast break. And St. Paul Central is going to call timeout as Chanhassen goes on a 15-8 lead. We talked about Chanhassen not having the biggest of lineups, nobody above 5'10", and that includes their post players. And then when they lost Tori Shear to the ACL tear, I spoke with Angie Kissick, the Chanhassen head coach. She said instead of trying to replace her by position, they opted to distribute her scoring, get more players involved in rebounding, and kind of convert everybody else into more all-around talent. Go with a smaller lineup, and one advantage of that, you may not have the size down low, but you certainly have the speed, which is very difficult to stop. As we mentioned, they were 8-19 their first year, 4-12 in the conference, and in just their second year, their first winning record as a team, 17-9, when they were relocated to the Minnesota, and then we talked about 22-5 last year. Their first victory did not come, though, until December 10th, 2009, when they beat Mount Wistanka 57-32 at home. Their first game of the year was a loss to Bloomington Jefferson 56-42. That was a road game. And Williams missed on the pass, and Kizert couldn't handle it. And another miscue from Central, not what they were looking for. Chanhassen's first home game, by the way, was a 64-47 loss to Waconia. But since then, it's been only uphill for Chanhassen. Chanhassen was looking to go inside, and they commit a turnover as Shiplett stepped out of bounds. The pass from Smith was a little too high. Williams tried to get rid of it, but there was not enough help there for Central in that possession. And McDonald's going to get called for the foul as she jumped on top of Olivia Wilder. Not intentionally, of course, but it will still get called in the foul book. Not many fouls yet. McDonald has one and Williams has one for Central, but clean game so far. And a big time swish from Danielle Gitson. Gitson doing very well from short range. Kizer couldn't handle the pass, and you're noticing that with Central. They're not able to handle these transition plays the way Chanhassen has. Shiplett for three. Off the rim. Chatman rips the board away. But you look at Chanhassen on defense. They're going for pokes. McDonald lines up the three. No good. Chanhassen comes up with it. And a nice play from behind that will stop Wilder from getting another transition layup. Chanhassen up 17-8. Gitson, who has scored three baskets from short range, very athletic in the words of Angie Kissick. But she's not the only one. Gitson couldn't save it. Gitson averaging just 7 points a game coming into this match. And Chanhassen's offense non-existent against Providence Academy, but that is their style of play, and they are the defending 2A champions. Providence, I watched a bit of that game at Hopkins on Saturday. Providence was able to establish their tempo, and Chanhassen could not get much on offense as a result. McDonald over to Curtis. And Curtis is hacked. We mentioned Curtis averaging 11.3 points off the bench. That's going to be on number 32, Lauren Shifflett. Willie Taylor describes Curtis as his best low block offensive player, but he wants to see her pick up some more defensive tenacity. Says she sometimes lets the player get to the ball, and Willie Taylor wants his players to make Chanhassen work for every possession, even on passes. Curtis splits. Jump ball. St. Paul Central with the possession arrow. And just another example of the rebounding ability of Sade Chatman. Jada Haynes to inbound. There's Curtis, that's what we talked about, but her shot is off the heel, and it's picked up by Udston. And Jada Jones is gonna get hit with a foul. Gitson now playing a little point. Udston inside with Curtis in her face. That's always a tough shot. Here's Jada Jones, pull up. No. And Chanhassen will be called for the push, so Central will keep the ball on this end of the floor. .849 remaining in the first half. Haynes feeding inside to Curtis. Can't get around the double team though. And she ends up committing a foul. Central still has two to give. Smith looking for Udston, finds her. That's Litchie, in trouble, gets out of it. Now fires a 15-footer that's off the heel. Another jump ball, Chanhassen with the possession arrow. Two. Shifflett and Sherow step in for their respective teams. Smith inbounding, finds Gitson. Udsted in trouble, but finds Shifflett down low. And Shifflett gets her first basket. Chanhassen up by 10. McDonald pulls up a three, in and out. Rebound, Jones, no. Sherow will get free throws. Sherow with 4 points, but St. Paul Central in a field goal drought of sorts. Sherow, a junior, still has some time, but is getting some offers from Division I schools. Last year, the best player on the team in terms of statistics. And compliments Chatman in rebounding, but has a little more offense to her game. She gets both here. She's up to six. Shifflett. Yes! Off the bounce pass from Becca Smith. And Shifflett getting some action now. McDonald pulls up again. Swish! That's her first field goal. Let's see if that restores her confidence in her shot. Smith left alone. No. But nobody was able to box out in time, and Shifflett will get a second chance, but she can't drain it. And Central picks it up. McDonald has a one-on-one with Becca Smith, uses up her steps, and scores on the coast-to-coast play. McDonald with two baskets back-to-back, and Shifflett is hacked by Curtis. Central thought it was a clean block, but either way, Curtis at least stopped another fast break opportunity. Chanhassen has been able to push the ball throughout most of this game so far. So Shifflett at the line for a pair. Shifflett will be going to play college basketball at Concordia St. Paul, where she will be a future opponent of Betsy McDonald, who is going to St. Cloud State, as they're both members of the Northern Sun Intercollegiate Conference. She can play inside or outside, as you see, not afraid to post up defenders or take advantages of mismatches. And you saw with Curtis there, she's not afraid to get hacked. Gets both. And Chanhassen pushes the lead back to eight. Sherow for three. Bullseye! You don't see that often. Williams with the poke and the strip. Curtis almost to travel. Oh, she can't weave through the hole, and Sherow too strong. Curtis is fouled. Free throws coming. Curtis split her last time up. Foul is on Wright, her first personal. Shifflett has two fouls, for those of you keeping track. And Curtis leaves that one short. Central may have an improved roster compared to previous years. I mean, by their standards, kind of a few down years after their 2008 state tournament. Again, they have yet to qualify for a state championship since then, but free throws, not one of their strengths in current teams. That was one of their
strong suits, of course, in those glory years. Curtis splits again when you have players like Kiara Buford and Abby Gust and Angel Robinson who could hit them with regularity. McDonald was going to get the steal, and Chanhassen commits a foul. It's on Litchi. That is her second personal, and Chanhassen out of fouls to give. Central with just one. Kizzard, how did she put that in? Kind of hit herself between those two defenders. Not very tall, 5'7", and that might be generous on the program, but got the lob to fall. Central back within two. They were trailed by as much as 10. And Litchi is fouled from behind. Central now out of fouls to give, but Litchi will shoot a pair. Fouls on Kizzard, her first. Litchi, one of the team captains, played on the varsity roster since her freshman year, so one of the players who has the distinction of being with Chanhassen throughout their entire existence. Of course, that won't be true come next year. When possible, likes to push the tempo along with her teammates. And in the words of Angie Kissick, her teammates feed off of her when she's fired up. So she's looking for Litchi to be a leader and demonstrate those examples on the floor this season as Chanhassen looks to do what they have never done before, and that's win a playoff game. Of course, that won't be settled until late February. Litchi split. Kizzard was way off on the drive attempt, and here's Smith on the other end. She can't get the roll, but gets in with the rebound. Chanhassen with another possession. Here's Litchi. That falls short. Kizzard can't handle it and throws it right into the hands of Chanhassen. That was Wilder. And here's Shifflett with a little shovel pass to Litchi for the layup. Kizzard to Williams. Central resetting. Chanhassen staying in their man. Williams stripped. Sherow, not good angle there. And Curtis, no. Sherow, no. Not the greatest awareness of court spacing on that possession for Central. And that's not what you want to do. Chanhassen was in the bonus as it is, but Becca Smith will shoot a pair. And as you saw on that attempt, can get to the rim off the dribble. Also plays on the track team for Chanhassen. And that agility is thanks to a great first step. So Chanhassen getting a little distance here after Central cut the margin to two. Smith up to 7 points. And Chanhassen very balanced so far. You've got 7 points for Smith, 6 for Gitson, 6 for Shifflett, 5 for Litchi. Sherow with most of Central's points. She has 9, but not as much distribution. But Central's shot selection a little off, and Lyric Williams perhaps took an ill-advised 3-point attempt. Shifflett, good defense by Sherow to disrupt her. And Central stops a fast break bucket that time. Sherow, no charge called, and she gets the basket. Officials let it go, and Sherow having a great game to keep St. Paul Central in contention. She has 11 points. Litchi, Smith calling for it, but Williams gets two there before she can get the 3-point shot off. Pass down low, and Sherow commits the foul. And that's gonna, should send Smith to the line. Because Central is in the penalty. Well, actually it will send Shifflett to the line. This is a one-on-one situation, of course. Now, Shifflett is a player who leads by example, in the words of Kissick. Very aggressive and an effective floor general. Shifflett splits, though. It is worth noting that Central only down by six. Even though the flow, the style of this game would suggest that Chanhassen has been the dominant team throughout. Sherow in trouble, and Chanhassen bails her out. Chanhassen also in the penalty. Fouls on Gitson. Ruled a shooting foul, so two free throws coming for Sherow. And Sherow can't get the bounce. Curtis races in, but too strong. You see Central not quite composed on those putback attempts. Curtis, no. Gets another one. And gets the kiss off the glass. I lost track as to how many chances Central got in that position, but offensive rebounding, as in one of their specialties, with Sherow and Curtis inside. Again, need to work on getting a little more settled on those shots, and Chanhassen, that rims out. Central could tie in this possession, but Central doing a very good job of crashing the boards to get those second chance opportunities. Less than 2 minutes to go in the first half. No shot clock, so you can take as long as you need to. McDonald on a fake. Rashondra Curtis drains the short range jumper. McDonald pulled off a no-look pass of sorts. Shifflett pulls up, too strong. Central could take the lead. McDonald has a chance. Yes! Kissick will call timeout with 1:13 left in the first half. Central scoring the last 7 points. Betsy McDonald, as you saw in that last play. Again, one of Willie Taylor's favorite players to coach in his career. And it's because of her basketball IQ. She can handle it ambidextrously, meaning right or left hand, but very smart on the floor, knows when to make passes, knows when to take a shot, and has a very good sense of how to orchestrate her teammates. Central hasn't had that on every roster. In the championship year of 07, they had a phenomenal point guard in Angel Robinson, who still holds the state record for steals. Kiana Johnson took over the following year when they won the state title. Not quite as strong as Robinson, but still effective. But then after that, they just didn't have a strong point guard to lead the offense. McDonald slowly stepped up in that role over the years. Chanhassen was looking to go inside. to right, but Central steals it. Central picking up a few cues now from the Chanhassen offense. They may elect to hold for the final shot. Unless they see an opening. Jada Jones is going to try. Can't get the foul, though. Sometimes it can be a little too aggressive, and that's something you see in high school ball. Now Central pressing again. The 10-second rule is in effect. Chanhassen does get it over. And Jada Haynes pushes Shifflett on the floor. And that's going to give free throws for the Storm. Unfortunate miscue there by one of Willie Taylor's starters. Still a 1-1. Shiplett with 7 points. Shiplett, one of many Minnesota players to go to Concordia St. Paul. Of course, that's quite common in the lower divisions, but a lot of Minnesota ties, including their assistant coach, Kasheen Alexander, who was a star at Iowa. Got drafted by the Lynx, was waived, though. Didn't really have much of a chance there to go pro, but Shiplett will also join the likes of players like Carissa Wolinick. Kianda Nix is also there. Central will not get a shot off because they stepped on the line. Chanhassen might have a chance here with 2 seconds. But they're not going to get one. That ends the first half. A very competitive first half. Chanhassen started out in front and had control for most of it, but Central rallied back. And now we have a 31-30 score at the end of the first chapter. We'll pause for a few minutes and come back to recap the scoring and other notes. You're watching high school girls basketball on TSB television. Welcome back to St. Paul Central. As we continue our coverage of high school girls basketball on TSB television, it's a non-conference match between St. Paul Central and Chanhassen. I'm Mike Peden, and let's take a look at our first half stats. Chanhassen, a balanced effort so far. Lauren Shifflett leading with 9 points. Becca Smith has 7, Daniel Gitson with 6, and Elitchie has 5. St. Paul Central, most of the offense going through Rayna Sherow. She has 12 points. Betsy McDonald has 6. LaShondra Curtis also with 6, but Sade Chatman with 4. And again, that's one of the differences between Sherow and Chatman that Willie Taylor talked about. Sherow a little more aggressive on offense, Chatman preferring to shore up the defensive end. Chanhassen looking to bounce back from their loss to Providence Academy. St. Paul Central looking to extend their best start since 2006-07. So St. Paul Central will inbound to start the second half. They're wearing the black jerseys. Chanhassen wearing the white. Chanhassen early was able to establish their transition game and their quick tempo. St. Paul Central tried to do that, but got a little too trigger happy and not enough discipline. We'll see if that changes in half number 2. Close game, though. Williams loses the ball, and it bounces off the tripod. It was ruled off of Chanhassen, though, so Central will hold on to it. Chatman, that was a tough spot to fire from. Had defenders all around. Here's Gitson. She's short. Litchie on the offensive board, but she can't hang on to it. Gitson does, but in an effort to save it, it's picked off by McDonald. McDonald to Sherow, off the backboard and in. We talked about McDonald's vision allowing St. Paul Central's offense to flourish. Sherow with 14. Litchie off the rim, no good. Picked up by Haynes. Haynes in trouble. Gets it over to the point guard, McDonald. And Chatman to Sherow, too strong on the pass. And Sherow had a little too much velocity of her own. Gitson for three, off the heel. Sherow with the rebound. She finds Williams down court. Can she get there? No. Utstead picks it up. I should say that's Tia Wright. Wright, kiss off the glass. Wright was quiet in the first half. She only has 4 points. Here's McDonald. And good pick by Litchie. And that's going to lead to a Chanhassen basket. That's Olivia Wilder scoring. And Willie Taylor will call timeout with 16:04 remaining in the second half, and Chanhassen up by 3 points. Wilder with only 4 points, her name not mentioned much either. But one of the players to watch this year for Chanhassen. She says when necessary, she can do the worm. Also involved in the Active Member Fellowship for Christian Athletes, the FCA. A captain for her local Relay for Life organization. I took part in the U of M Relay for Life a couple of years, and that was a lot of fun. Great cause to be a part of. Also participates in DECA, intramural volleyball, and powder puff football. Now that's an interesting activity, which you don't see much of either. Not many folks do that anymore. So St. Paul Central will try to clean things up. Jane's missing the three-pointer. The rebound falls in the hands of Chatman, and Sherow left open for the basket. Chanhassen clogged the inside, clogged the paint, and then they veered away from that when Chatman got the rebound, and they forgot about Sherow. McDonald, no. And it's picked up by number 24 for Chanhassen, Brooke Benson. This is her first appearance in the game. Becca Smith scoring. Looking for Sherow again on the entry pass, and Utstead fouls her. McDonald, skip pass over to Kizzard, and Haynes lines up the three, but she's gonna be off target. Kizzard on the rebound and the foul, and Kizzard will shoot a pair. Kizzard averaging 6.2 points per game. As Kizzard steps up to the line. Also a volleyball player and runs track. So a three sport athlete for the Minutemen. A lot of athletes, of course, take part in that. Some will do the AAU circuit, or fall leagues and they focus on one sport, but others like Kizer choose to focus on three sports, which I think gives you a chance to kind of get a break from one sport and trying to do it all. And some have talked about whether or not playing nearly year-round does anything for skills, but Chanhassen working the ball around. That's Utston on the score. Chanhassen up by five. McDonald, long three. Yes! That's her first tray. Utstead kicks out. Chanhassen resetting. Utstead, no. Gets her own rebound. Can't get the put back though. And Sherow makes sure there will not be a third try. Haynes, no look over to Chatman. Another no, well, that was a look, but Sherow was short on the fadeaway. Chatman cleans up the mess. Six for Chatman. We're tied at 39. Gitson breaks the tie with a swish. Gitson with eight. Considerable difference in scoring between the two teams. McDonald, uh-oh. Well, almost had it, but Sherow was there for the cleanup on the offensive board, I should say, and she will shoot a pair. Rayna Sherow, we mentioned a junior. One of her dreams or passions or interests, something she would like to learn, is snowboarding. And she's always wanted to learn how to take it part of that. Sherow also played volleyball. Looking forward to playing track and field this year. She leads all players in scoring with 17. It's a 1-point game in favor of Chanhassen, but again, St. Paul Central having to go through Sherow to get most of their offense. Chanhassen spreading it around. Nobody on the Storm with more than nine. Udstead rejected by Chatman, but it goes right to Smith, and Chanhassen will get another chance, and they draw the foul. That will put Shifflett back on the charity stripe. The foul is on Jada Jones, her second personal. And Shifflett, the first Chanhassen player to break double figures. Shifflett up to 11, Chanhassen up by three. McDonald having some trouble getting the inbound pass off. Again, that's Chanhassen's defense. Using central strategy, Williams with the steal right back, but the pass is a little short. Chatman does recover though. And a blocking foul is going to be called on Shifflett. And that is going to be number three for Chanhassen's top score. Ruled a shooting, no, it wasn't. That really wasn't a shooting foul. Players thought it was, but Chatman was not in position to pull that off. McDonald was looking for Curtis, does get it to her. Actually, that was Williams. McDonald on a little pull up, no good. Curtis, rebound, but stripped. Here's Smith on a little shovel pass over to Utstead, but that comes up short. Chatman picks up the rebound. Work it off. McDonald out to Chatman. Curtis. Not quite there. Gitson can't handle the pass, so Chanhassen will have to score on a set play. Traveling violation on Chanhassen. And speaking of set plays, that was something when the team first got together, there was not much experience from anybody. And Kissick said, no, we didn't force them into a lot of set plays, just gave them a lot of chance to get a feel for the court. And whatever strategy Kissick took has paid off. Of course, Kissick, no stranger to the sport herself, played high school ball at St. Peter. Curtis, no. McDonald offensive rebound, goes to Chatman, but she's gonna be short. And it's gonna go to Chanhassen.
In for the score, number 15, T.O. Wright. Also in for the score, number 32, Laura Shifflett.
Kissick went on to play college basketball at the University of South Dakota. They never coached them into any set plays. And her mantra from day one is all about acquiring knowledge. McDonald with the steal. A little bit of a mix-up there, and now McDonald will fire the three. That's a little more within her range. Williams, how about that? Chatman, no. And Central has left a lot of opportunities, a lot of points on the table off of second chances. They've had several of them, but just don't quite have that patience or the discipline yet to get good looks, shooting just not there tonight. And Jones is gonna get hit with a third personal foul. In theory, Chanhassen could run out the final 10 minutes and 30 seconds with no shot clock, but again, most high schools will not do that until the final minutes. And in her face, but draining the three is Lauren Shifflett. Had a defender in her face, and Chanhassen up by five. Shifflett up to 14. Williams for the counter, bullseye. They called Shiflett's basket a two. Williams with the steal. So Shiflett with 13. Looked like a three, but still a good basket on Shiflett's end. Sherow didn't have anything there and threw it right into the hands of Olivia Wilder, who's fouled by Lyric Williams. Again, we talked about Wilder and all the activities she takes part in. When she goes to college, wants a dorm room with plenty of closet space. But that was not ruled a shooting foul. Foul away from the ball, it's gonna be on St. Paul Central. It's charged to Curtis, that is her third personal. And we will see some strategy extrapolate itself in the closing minutes of this contest as the fouls start accumulating. 5-second violation on the Storm. Very close contest. It's been fun, very fun to see which set of pressure defense will prevail. Williams, a little too wild there. But Central does keep the ball, but they're passing a little off target. Curtis Snow, Haynes, and one! Off balance as well. Good time to get your first field goal. Can't get the three-point plate though, but Sherow with the offensive rebound, and they get a four-point play out of that possession. Rayna Sherow dominating on offense, 19 points. Shifflett too strong, Central with the lead, and Chanhassen commits a foul. They are now out of fouls to give. Haynes hitting the floor. And a timeout is called by Chanhassen. They have two remaining. 47-45, Central up, and looking to defend their home court and stay 5-0. Well, we'd like to talk about unusual factoids, and so here are a few more for you. Since Chanhassen called the timeout, we're going to pick on them. Unfortunately, we mentioned Toy Shear couldn't play, but it's worth hearing her story. Also takes part in track and field, the National Honor Society, the International Club, the Link Crew, and also a member of the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. Would like to go to a Big Ten school. Not sure how those plans will hold up with the injury, but again, very talented post. A huge Los Angeles Lakers fan. And Shifflett, whose name we've called a few times for the Storm. A huge fan of the Disney characters and specifically the Disney princesses. I wonder if Princess Leia is included in that list now, since of course Lucasfilm is owned by Disney after the recent transaction. Also, a proficient fisher says she can outperform most of her male peers when it comes to fishing. Another FCA member, concert choir, Link Crew leader, also in an international club. So that gives you a taste of what Chanhassen does on and off the court. Back to action here. Williams was bumped by Becca Smith. That last foul on Chanhassen, by the way, against Litchi, put her at four. Smith not quite sure how many fouls she has, and the officials now recall that St. Paul Central is in the bonus, so that will put Lyric Williams at the line. But she leaves it empty. What a fun non-conference game this has been in the early part of the year. Playing as expected. Gets in for three, short. Offensive rebound, Becca Smith. Wilder stayed on top of it. Wright is open, off the heel. Williams with it. And Williams gonna try to go off the screen and hand it over to McDonald. A little more wiser now, not gonna try to take the ball up herself in that situation with the way Chanhassen homes in on the player with the ball. McDonald is fouled and will shoot a pair.
On White's number 50, Tito Wright. Her second team.
McDonald. One of her nicknames, Betts. The right, foul is on right, her second personal. McDonald bricks the front end. Also a member of the school band and plays soccer, so chances are she will get to perform at her high school graduation next spring at the Roy Wilkins Auditorium. McDonald splits, that gives her 10. And a lot of Chanhassen players, part of the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, but even some of the pros you would consider membership there. Lyric Williams from the pass by McDonald. Those long skip passes can be dangerous at times, but if well placed, lead to transition buckets, and Chatman is going to get called for the foul as she bumped Litchie. Central up 50-45. That is their largest lead of the game. The foul is Chapman's first, so she is in no trouble there. Central still has one to give. But don't count Chanhassen out. For the most part, they have equalized Central's attack, Central's strategy. And Jada Jones is going to get hit with her fourth personal foul. She was a little too close on the coverage of Becca Smith. So both teams with one player, one foul away from disqualification. Jones will be subbed out. And Litchie still on the floor for the Chanhassen Storm. Anna Litchie, of course. Here's Olivia Wilder, short. And the foul from behind, it's on Becca Smith, and that's gonna send Jada Haynes to the charity stripe for a one-on-one situation. St. Paul Central didn't have a bad year last year. Finished 20-7. Lost to White Bear Lake in the section final, 43-30. One of the lower scoring games of the year. Haynes, this is her second trip. She missed a three-point play. Not a whole lot of action tonight. Just 3 points as she splits there. St. Paul Central tied for the conference championship in the St. Paul City last year, but did not play in the Twin Cities game because Highland Park had a longer gap between appearances. It's a little strange tiebreaker procedure, and it led to a very ugly game between Highland and Roosevelt with the lack of discipline on the court, I should say. Litchie is fouled, and Central out of fouls to give. Will free throws settle this? Anna Litchie has not scored in the second half. Has 5 points. And the gym falls silent. Not what you'll see in the state tournament, of course, when fans are a little louder, but. This quaint atmosphere is suitable. Anna Litchie splits, she's up to 6. Imagine both teams in the bonus now. A little more reaching and a little more grabbing, and Lyric Williams trying to find Haynes. Once again, that was Kizzard, I should say. Now Lyric Williams comes in. And outside of Betsy McDonald, players like Williams and Kizzard have struggled tonight against the pressure defense from Chanhassen. Effectively stymied. Smith was open, but opts to drive instead, and may regret that choice as Chatman was there to scoop the ball away. Here's Sherow. We haven't heard much from her in a few minutes, but she comes up short. It's going to go to Chanhassen. 5-point game, 6:36 remaining in regulation. And an entertaining contest. Perhaps even close to mesmerizing. It's fun to see St. Paul Central, though, go toe-to-toe with the top teams again. Counted for Lauren Shifflett. And with our math corrected, she's up to 15. And a steal once again. Williams commits the foul. Like we said, when Central goes away from players like McDonald to run the point, run the floor, Central has no response, no solution. Olivia Wilder shooting a pair. Well, you didn't think Chanhassen was going to bow out of this one. Too much ebb and flow on both sides for this game to be a runaway. Wilder splits, she's up to 5. More pressure defense coming, but Central breaks it this time. They can't get a fast break look, but they're going to opt to use their passing instead, and Haynes is brought to the floor by Shifflett. That is her fourth personal foul. Haynes, 1 of 3. And free throws have been going both ways, effectively. Haynes leaves it empty. Sherow can't get the put back. Chatman hits the floor, and she is fouled. The foul is on Udsten, I believe. It is, and that's her third. Central in the double bonus. And Chatman, who has been very quiet tonight on offense, just 7 points. But her height and speed for a forward got the attention of the University of Alabama, Birmingham. And next winter will become a UAB Blazer. But Willie would like to also see her become more aggressive on offense, as we talked about, but also guard the 2 and 3 slots. She's quite adept at the 4 and the 5. But she gets 2 big free throws here to give Central a 4-point lead. And Wilder cuts it to 1. We talked about it again. And Willie Taylor will call timeout. Central with 3 remaining. Chanhassen with just 1. Willie Taylor seeing enough of Chanhassen's in-your-face approach, limiting what Central can do in the backcourt. As we've mentioned in this game, if McDonald is not bringing the ball up the floor, Central's players seem to be baffled at how to get out of those traps, those double teams. .518 remaining. Haynes to inbound, does find Williams, and prevents Chanhassen from putting up another trap. Sherow has been off a few times. And she has 19 points, but she has left a lot of shooting opportunities empty as well. Mixed bag for her, but Central will take it right now. It was on the line, and the officials rule off of Chanhassen. Danielle Gitson going back in. And Shifflett also going in for the Chanhassen Storm. Again, she has four fouls. Central may keep note of that. McDonald, that would have been a huge three. No foul called there, and that time it is. Chanhassen will go to the free throw line. Again, they are in the bonus as well. Hudson, just one field goal on the night. Hudson pure. And Chanhassen retakes the lead. 1 point game. Chanhassen trying to trap again. They do not give much space. McDonald, that may have been deflected, but McDonald gets her own board. Shovel pass to Sherow, who gets the cleanup on a play that was nearly broken. Sherow at 21. And this is the time where she needs to come up clutch. 4 minutes. Here's Gitson, she's had a solid game, but comes up short on the layup. Gets her own offensive rebound. Central fans wanted to travel. Christmas coming early, fouled. And number 30, Anna Litchi. We'll go back to the free throw line. Both teams in the double bonus now.
Fouls on Central's number 15, Rayna Sherow.
Fouls on Sherow, that's only her second, so she's doing okay there. You have Lyric Williams, though, and Jada Jones with four fouls for Central. Shiplett with four for Chanhassen, but throw that out the window now, Chanhassen. Coming to form from the charity stripe now. Litchi has not scored a field goal in the second half, but she gives Chanhassen the lead and has worked her way up to 8 points. That's off Gitson, so Central will get another try, but once again, Chanhassen invading most of the passing lanes, making Central work to just get a ball in bounds. And here's Jada Jones. We'll keep an eye on this. Chanhassen will try to trap again. Deshondra Curtis, oh, that was too strong, and she had a good look too. And that is a critical error. Chanhassen going for three. No, that would have been huge. And it's off of Olivia Wilder. Central will try again. Sherow not on the floor right now for Central. even though she has been their top player tonight. An interesting coaching move by Willie Taylor, given where he's at right now. And Jones trying to find McDonald, threw it right into the passing lane that Chanhassen had occupied. And once again, they'll have a chance to extend this lead. Again, in this situation, do you kill or do you push? You're only up by one, so that doesn't give you a whole lot of room for error. And that's why Wilder stepped on the line on the drive attempt. McDonald with the ball now. And Chanhassen opting not to use full court this time. Some strategies bucking the trend. McDonald with the drive to the lane. McDonald with a very quiet dozen, and hey, who turned out the lights? Let's see if that changes anything. Lights got a little darker on this floor. And a foul on Central. Depending on who it's on, that might mean somebody's getting sent to the bench. No, it's on Curtis, so she is now sitting with four. Curtis, Jones, and Williams all have four fouls now. And Central not having a deep bench available. Asiya Smith unable to play tonight. It's Tia right at the line. And the remaining players, Paul and Curtis and Greenwald, usually put in for stat padding or garbage time situations. But here comes Sherow. The lights may be dimmed, but the excitement's still brimming. No! Offensive rebound, Chanhassen. Olivia Wilder with a big time board. Both teams gotta be careful now, again in the double bonus, so any foul means two free throws automatically. Chanhassen taking their time. Becca Smith jukes her defender and scores. She is up to 11. Now the pressure's on Central, and once again, that full court defense. And Willie Taylor's gonna have to call timeout to prevent the Central Minutemen from committing another 10 second violation. That would be the first one, but Central with two timeouts remaining. Chanhassen with one, 59-57. Let's look at the foul situation one more time. Central has three players with four fouls. Again, though, their bench pretty short. Lyric Williams has four. Jada Jones has four. LaShondra Curtis has four. Chanhassen, only one player with four fouls, Lauren Shifflett. Both teams in the double bonus. Central looking to preserve their undefeated record. Chanhassen looking to make another potent statement to the rest of 4A, and the lights come back on. Which team will get the shining moment to end this game? We still don't know. Jones will inbound it. Finds Williams, but right in the corner. But Williams evades the pressure. Finds Sherow. No! Chatman! Yes! Sade Chatman with a big putback. We're tied at 59. Overtime may not be out of the question here. And another drive and a kiss off the glass for Danielle Gitson. She's up to 10. 1 minute to go. Central really hasn't been tested much this season. Williams out of control there. Sherow picks it up and finds Chatman. She'll go back to Sherow with one-on-one coverage, and she gets the bounce. 23 points for Rayna Sherow. She was averaging just 7.2 coming into this. And Angie Kissick will use her final timeout for the Chanhassen Storm. 23.9 seconds. Central still has two timeouts, but they can't use any at this point because they don't have possession. Chanhassen will likely hold for the final shot unless they get a good look. And it's worth mentioning, since we are looking at this possibility, if we go to overtime, we'll play an extra 4 minutes and each team will get one additional timeout. Fouls do carry over, which would put St. Paul Central in the metaphorical pickle. The first major test of the year for both teams. As you mentioned, St. Paul Central breezed through the Pat Patterson tournament games, defeating New Prague and Monticello pretty soundly. Chanhassen, New Prague and St. Anthony Village, I should say. Chanhassen at a Minneapolis South team that didn't have its full complement of players. That was a blowout win. Waconia a little closer, but they pulled away to win by 15. Providence Academy, a blowout loss, but unable to adapt to Providence's tempo. You hear from the fans, no foul. Central does not want to foul here. 15 seconds. Chanhassen holding for the final shot. Williams trying for it. You don't want to get too aggressive though and leave your player open down low. 5 seconds. And the pass is picked up by Chatman. She's going down to Sherow. Here it comes for the win. No! And we're headed for overtime. Unbelievable. Chanhassen was holding for the final shot. It was picked off by Chatman, who found Sherow, and Sherow just didn't have enough time. So here's what happens. Both teams get one additional timeout. The clock says 5 minutes, it should be four. We end up playing with five though. Enforcement of the rules in the high school league, sometimes not as uniform, but that's not something I can control. So once again, both teams get one additional timeout and we may end up playing with 5 minutes. Well, why not? It'll add to the uncertainty. Okay, I think now they addressed it, so it should be set to four. And now they're going to fix it. One of the central coaches brought to the attention of the officials that it should be 4 minutes, unless they changed it to five, and I wasn't aware of it. They're gonna go with five. Well, why not add to this unpredictability? This I do know, both teams get one additional timeout and the fouls carry over, so both teams will shoot free throws for this extended period. That may favor Chanhassen because they do not have as many players with four fouls. Central has three. And that's one of them, Lyric Williams. That's another Jada Jones. Jump ball, and the possession arrow is not lit up. Willie Taylor arguing that Chanhassen did not have possession of that ball. So the strange turns and twists continue. We have an extra minute of overtime. And now we figured out who had the possession arrow. It was Central. Well, one thing's for sure, when you get to the state tournaments or the playoff time, there will not be any doubt over overtime stipulations. And Sherow fouls Shifflett. That's going to be her third on the reach-in. I'm not sure this game will be fouled under protest, even with the extra minute of overtime. But again, that's going to make for more unpredictability. Shifflett with 15 points and now at 16. Approaching her scoring average now. Well, depending on how this overtime goes, maybe that extra minute will be helpful. Jones, that was nearly a travel. And that was not a good attempt. Not good shot selection there. Chanhassen, though, in a similar position as they have been before when they've had leads. They cannot back off too much because they only have a 2-point lead. One slip up and Central will be right back in this. Jones loses possession and it's off her leg. You see Central getting a little aggressive, maybe too aggressive here, trying to score and tie this game up. There's still a lot of time. As we said, we have an extra 60 seconds on top of it. At least by my understanding of the rules. Shifflett goes around Sherow, but Chatman was there to get in front. But Sherow with another reach and foul. And that's going to give her four. We had an overtime game before in our brief season of coverage thus far, and Kennedy did not score in that period. Providence won by making free throws. Neither team scored a field goal. Will that happen a second time? We'll find out. But Shifflett in rhythm now. Matches her scoring average. Split, so it's still a one possession game, 64-61. Chatman was looking to go to McDonald, but Chanhassen was swarming like a beehive. A three-pointer ties it. Chatman, no. Sherow is fouled. Sherow with 23 points. Foul is on right, her third. Sherow, though, not the most accurate free throw shooter for Central. Again, though, they don't have a sharp shooter from the charity stripe on the roster, so that means you can leave a few points from the line. Chatman can't get it off, and it once again missed opportunities. Willie Taylor will call timeout. He did have three available. And if Central cannot fight back to win this game, that's what it may come down to. The missed free throws and those missed chances, those bricks, those empty second chances. Their superior rebounding ability has demonstrated and manifested as we expected. But they may need to work on finishing and again, just being a little more patient and not rushing shots the way they seem to have done against Chanhassen tonight. But still, a very good game for Central. Now getting it as their first true test of the year. I mean, Willie Taylor, looking at that schedule, said this was going to be the first big test we've had. And with the format, as we talked about before, the format, the structure, losses not too damaging at this point. It may have some implications on state tournament seeding. Wow! Williams took a dive. Slow to get up. And Haynes commits a foul. Kind of needless. Because that puts Shiplett at the line, and she has been fairly accurate as of late. You still could have played defense if you were Central. That foul was not necessary. But Chanhassen leaving some points at the free throw line now. Here comes Sherow again. In for Haynes. Sherow with four fouls. Shifflett splits, makes it a two possession game. And Chanhassen got here late, got caught up in traffic, and didn't get here until 6:20. So how about that? Not having as much time to prepare. Chatman saves it. McDonald, holy cow, pulls off an underhand layup. Even if Central doesn't win, that's the play of the game. Three-pointer, no. And Litchie can't save it in time. I don't care who wins the game. McDonald just gave us the play of the game. McDonald with 14. And Central can tie it again. Now, the contingency of fans that are here, not many of them. Again, non-conference though. You'll probably see more when we get to conference play. Still cheering them on though. Sherow, that was short. Ball tipped out. Here's Kizzert. Swish! And we're tied at 65. Quit, not in the vocabulary of either roster. Fans are active now. Litchie open. Smith on the offensive rebound. No foul called. Here comes Kizzert. Can she get down there in time? No. But Williams gets in there for the offensive rebound. And Central now settling down. Kizzert will pump fake the three. Goes to Sherow. And gets the turnaround, Jay. Sherow with 25. Chanhassen does have a timeout left. And again, the game should be over in about 12 seconds, but one extra minute was put on erroneously. Let's see what happens now as we enter that final phase. And a nice little give and go from Chatman to Sherow. Well, go figure. Angie Kissett calls timeout with exactly 1 minute left. Again, the minute that should not be on the clock, unless my knowledge of the rules is outdated. Sherow with 27 points, 69-65. We mentioned
I've said this many times, but again, high school league, 4 minute overtimes are the rule. 1 minute was added by the score, and the issue was not rectified. Even though Central has a two possession lead with 1 minute to go, this contest not over by any means. We've seen Chanhassen, they're more accurate from the free throw line, and they have some shot making abilities. But St. Paul Central coming up huge, scoring the last 8 points. And it started with that underhand trickery by Betsy McDonald. So the 1 minute of phantom time will now come into play. Now Central perhaps could have won, but you really can't extrapolate what if a 4 minute situation, because the strategy would be a little different. But Chanhassen wants to score, and they want to score quickly. Chatman, though, gets the deflection, and Sherow comes up with a steal. Litchie is fouled, and I believe it's on Sherow. Yes, and Sherow fouls out with 27 points. But the PA announcer giving a quick acknowledgement of her 27 points. But that is a huge loss. Central gets 30 seconds to come up with a replacement, but among them, he doesn't have many options. Lashondra Curtis has 4 fouls. And depending on what happens here in these final few seconds, Willie Taylor may have to go to one of his JV players. That is allowed in high school basketball. If your players take part in both varsity and JV, you can play up to 3 halves. So here is Anna Litchie with 8 points. Needs one to make it a one possession game again. It's early, but this has a state tournament feeling to it already. Litchie makes both. Central without Sherow for the final 46 seconds. Chanhassen gets the steal and into the hands of Tia Wright. Now Chanhassen with a big decision to make. They are out of timeouts. Central does not want to foul. They're going for the lead. No, that's short. McDonald with the rebound. And did she get fouled? It appears so. Yes, with 24.4. These will be two big free throws for McDonald, and it's a huge foul on Chanhassen because it's charged to Lauren Shifflett. She is out of the game. 19 points for Shifflett. A solid game on her end. We talked about all the things she was involved in, so ebb and flow going both ways with the players fouling out, the foul situation. One of the longer games I've done, but one of the more exciting games. It hasn't been because of a ticky-tack crew or lack of discipline or lazy defense. There have been some lapses. We have to acknowledge that, but just a very solid game, taking a strategical bend in both directions. And Betsy McDonald, the reason why she likes playing it, she said, are the people you meet along the way. And she's gonna make a few meetings out of this one. Kizer going back in. McDonald, as you saw, made the front end. That makes it a 3-point game. This to make it a 2-possession game. Pure. McDonald with 16. Chanhassen out of timeout, so they have to score quickly because the clock does not stop for a made basket. They're running out of time. 14 seconds, a very long possession here as Central's defense showing a bit of Chanhassen flair. Unable to get the bounces, Gitson. 5 seconds, that just might do it. Out of bounds it goes, but I don't think there's gonna be enough time for Chanhassen. Because even if Chanhassen scored, they could not stop the clock because they're out of timeouts. Willie Taylor will use one. He had two, and again, it was off an inbounds play, so this does not benefit Chanhassen. But St. Paul Central, it looked like they were headed for defeat, and unless something crazy happens in the last 4.5 seconds, appear that they will preserve their undefeated record. However, the one element, the one miscue they need to avoid at all costs is fouling on a 3-point shot that goes in. And I'm sure that's why Willie took the timeout to let his players know if they shoot the three, let them, because there will not be enough time for Chanhassen to get the ball back. But if they foul and Chanhassen makes a 3-pointer, the drama will multiply. Litchie to inbound. The only thing that can save Chanhassen now would be to get fouled on a 3-point make. And that's not gonna happen. Gitson gets the layup, but there will not be enough time. St. Paul Central escapes in overtime. 71-69, a phenomenal game on both ends. Exciting in the end. Very intense, very dramatic. Rayna Sherow, the game's high scorer with 27 points. And Lauren Shifflett leading Chanhassen with 19. We'll try to get a word with both those players in a couple minutes. You're watching high school girls basketball on TSB television. St. Paul Central wins 71-69. Mike Beaton here with Lauren Shifflett of Chanhassen. I know you weren't on the winning end of it, but just how exciting was it to play a game that went into overtime like that?
We probably shouldn't have got there, but I think we had it. I think we could have won. But I mean, just being in that situation, we got to work on it. I mean, being in a halftime situation, it's not always the best, but I mean, it goes back to 0-0 and you got to play like it's the start of the game. So
you were up 65-61 in that period. Central scored 8 straight. What happened from your perspective?
I think we just got frazzled, and I think at that point in time, I think we called the timeout a little too late, but I think we got to stay in it more, and we got to like work on those game situations during practice. But I mean, it happens. It's a game. Win, lose. There's a winner, loser. But I think we'll get next time.
And what do you think was demonstrated tonight in terms of tenacity and just, from what I saw on both teams, quit was not in the vocabulary of either team, any player. It was a very fun game all the way to the end.
I mean, we had last weekend we had Providence, and I think that didn't show like our talent and how we play our game. And I think tonight we were a little better, and we play our game. We play Chanhassen basketball, and we hustle, we're strong, and we just like get after it, and yeah.
Now you're going to Concordia St. Paul. Obviously you want to make sure Chanhassen, you know, perhaps gets a playoff and even a state tournament appearance before you go, but what are you looking to do to set yourself up when you go over to Concordia, where you're going to be competing against folks like Betsy McDonald, who's going to St. Cloud State up in the NSIC?
Yeah, it is going to be fun playing against these girls that I've played with all my life, but yeah, I just got to keep working on my game individually and as a team, and I just want to like work on my ball handling skills a little more and just play like more of a team player and just work on getting to Concordia, getting there.
And last question, is there anyone you want to say hi to that may be watching this?
Say hi to my family probably, and that's probably it.
Well, no matter the outcome, I'm sure they're proud of you, and so is Chanhassen as you've continued to grow as a team, and like it's still early, still a long way to go. So
I know we'll get better as the season goes by for sure.
Well, of course, it would be. You've got the talent to do it, and like I said, a lot of fun. This is all the learning experience now in that first month.
Exactly, we have a powerful player out with ACL tear, so we just kind of got to work around her and we kind of have to, I don't know, play without her, sort of. So we're just kind of getting used to it. So we'll do better.
Well, good luck and nice game tonight. And who knows, we might see Chanhassen again before the season's out.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Right. Lauren Shifflett of Chanhassen. Mike Peden here with Rayna Sherow. The game's high score tonight with 27 points. Let's tell me, what are the emotions of an overtime game as close as it was tonight?
Definitely butterflies. Everybody was really on the edge, didn't know what was going to happen. We were all working hard, trying not to turn the ball over. We were both 10-10 for fouls, so, you know, couldn't really foul. Had to make our free throws if we did get fouled, and it was just intense.
And you fouled out at 65-61. How nervous were you at that point?
I was a little nervous, not as nervous as it may have seemed. I was more shocked with the foul, but I mean, it happens. I had trusted my teammates that it was going to work out, and it did, so it wasn't too bad.
Speaking of that energy, that attitude, and their mood seemed to change when Betsy McDonald pulled a circus underhand layup from a double team that I thought was going to be a complete trap.
Yeah, that shot was definitely amazing, and that really did. That really was what set the tone. That was everything. Like, I couldn't believe it, and it just hyped everybody in the gym up. It really set the vibe.
And before that point, you had some big shots. There were some times when your shot was a little off target, but overall, you were crashing the boards, getting a lot of putbacks, and just really making it difficult for Chanhassen on the offensive side of the paint.
Well, yeah, before the game, my coach said to know to rebound, what we do best. I mean, we have three bigs, and most teams don't have that. So that's our advantage, getting boards in the rebound, making points in the paint. And I just knew that's what I had to do, so I tried to do it at my best.
This is more challenging than trying to snowboard?
Yeah, I never tried to snowboard.
I read that you've been wanting to do that, so maybe after this, maybe a way to unwind, because you learned how to get through a tough game. And talk about that, too. Central 5-0, it's their best start since 06-07 when they went undefeated and won the title. Just why do you think Central has reached that point?
I think this year we've realized how good we are and what we have and the talents that we have. And we're just starting to put it all together, and we know what we want more than ever. We want to go to state. We want to be the best that we can. And we just want to put everything that we have on the floor every chance that we get. So we're just starting to execute that more.
We're going to be here a few more times, including Saturday with Duluth East. And so what does Central need to improve on, and what do you think was efficient and effective tonight for the Minutemen that will be something to watch later on the season?
Something that I think we need to work better on is definitely our defense, knowing who we have, closing out on shooters, and just pretty much getting back on defense, make sure that everybody box out, not just one person, but everybody crashes the boards when the ball goes up. And one thing that I think we did good is getting the ball to the post, crashing the boards for some of us, and working as a team most of the time. If one person didn't do good, the other person picked them back up, and that pretty much helped with on the bench players and people that were on the floor.
And last question, anyone you want to say hi to that may be watching this?
All my friends and family. Hey, what's up?
Got all your
Vegas, yeah.
Got all your elements covered there of your fan base, so.
Yeah, general, you know, no one specific.
Yes, well, I'm sure this will boost your social profile by enormous amounts, maybe even ginormous amounts, but congratulations, Rayna Sherow. This was a very exciting game and a fun way to start this three-game homestand for Central.
Thank you.
Rayna Sherow of St. Paul Central, that concludes our coverage. Central winning in overtime. You're watching High School Girls Basketball.